My greetings and namaskars to all the young friends who have assembled from all the 10 ASEAN countries as well as from India. We were looking forward to meeting in a physical space for the 4th ASEAN-India Youth Dialogue, but due to this coronavirus situation, we had to turn to this digital platform to have this virtual meet of the youth leaders from ASEAN countries and India. I welcome all of you to this new edition of the virtual dialogue, but I look forward to a regular physical ASEAN-India Youth Summit taking place either later in this year or definitely in 2021. You are all youth leaders. It is sometimes said in a very charitable manner that youth are the future of a nation. I would probably like to put it differently. Youth are not the future anymore, they are the present of the nations in the world today. It is the youth that molds the destiny of the nations. They play a very critical role in shaping the futures of many countries. Countries in the ASEAN region are as civilizations very ancient countries. Some of the countries, in fact, I would say almost all the ASEAN countries have a history that goes back into several millennia. We have had highly enriched civilizations in our respective countries. Great cultures, great religions. We all take pride in our ancientness. But let me also underscore that we are all very young nations as well. When I say young nations, we are countries with massive youth bulge. India, like the other ASEAN countries, is also an ancient nation with a history of several millennia, but a country ever youthful, ever energetic, with more than 50% of its population having being below 35 years of age. In fact, many ASEAN countries also today boast of a youth bulge. They do have massive youth populations. ASEAN together has about 30% young population between the age group of 15 and 35. If you take people below the age of 15, this population of the young people will probably be on par with that of India's youth population. So we are ancient yet young countries. Youth of these countries have a huge responsibility in molding the future of all our countries. ASEAN, as we all know, is a grouping of 10 nations. A fairly diverse group of countries. If you look at individual nations in the ASEAN grouping, they don't speak the similar language. Their cultures are different. Their histories vary. Yet, they all came together to create a very stable and strong coalition in the Indo-Pacific region. The guiding principle for the ASEAN unity is united in diversity, meaning while ASEAN nations as individual nations have their own individual persona, they have their own identity, they have their own cultures, in the ASEAN grouping they are all together, but their individual identities matter, they are respected, and it is a grouping of diverse countries. They are united with a purpose. We in India also very fondly talk about this unity in diversity as a principle. India is also a very diverse country with people speaking at least 18 languages nationally recognized and close to 4,000 different dialects. There is vast diversity in the country in terms of religions, in terms of traditions, food, dress, in everything. India is a microcosm of various different cultures, traditions, languages, and rituals. Yet, as a nation, we are united, we are one. We also cherish this idea of unity in diversity. Interestingly, we two regions, India as a country and ASEAN as a group of nations, have had strong bilateral relations. It is almost 28, 29 years since India and ASEAN have come together to have bilateral understanding relationship. But let me tell you, friends, that the relationship at the level of our people, of our cultures, of our civilizations, dates back to the beginning of the Christian era. In over 2,000 years of our history, we have connected with each other, interacted with each other, enriched each other through that interaction. It is a relationship based on values. Shared values, common destiny. This is the principle that has guided the relationship between India and the ASEAN group of nations. In fact, the religions that all of us share, whether it is Hinduism or Buddhism or Islam or Confucianism or Christianity, we have a lot of things in common between India and the ASEAN group of nations in terms of our religious experiences. In fact, many of the religions that countries in Southeast Asia, part of the ASEAN grouping, today practice, have their origins in India. It is through traders, through preachers, through monks, that these religions have traveled from India to countries in the Southeast Asian region, enriched the lives there, and today have become integral to the value system of many of these countries. So our relationship is very old. Together, ASEAN and India are working on many fronts today. We have what we call as a free trade agreement between our between India and ASEAN group of nations. We have a strong bilateral trade to the tune of almost $100 billion. We both are situated in a region which is the most happening region in the world today, the Indo-Pacific region. India is an Indian Ocean country, and I don't hesitate to say that today Indian Ocean has emerged as central to the politics in the region. It has emerged as the central geopolitical region, geopolitical ocean in this region in which we live. And in Indian Ocean, India's centrality is indisputable. But then, beyond Indian Ocean, the Indo-Pacific, the confluence of two oceans, the Pacific Ocean and Indian Ocean, together has emerged as the global epicenter. Whereas Indian Ocean has emerged as the epicenter of the region, Indo-Pacific today has emerged as the epicenter of the entire world. And the centrality of ASEAN group of nations to this Indo-Pacific region is again indisputable. We are two entities who have become the most sought after entities in the world today. We are geographically located in the region that is the most happening region in the world today. So we have a responsibility individually and together to work for the well-being of this region, Indo-Pacific region in which we all live today, should be peaceful. It should be inclusive. It should be prosperous. And it should be secure. India, under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi, is actively pursuing the policy of Act East in order to achieve this objective of creating a peaceful, inclusive, prosperous, and secure Indo-Pacific region. In this, the role of the ASEAN nations is also very critical, because as the world leaders acknowledge, ASEAN is the pivot to the Indian Indo-Pacific region. Together, India and ASEAN nations have to work and strive towards achieving that objective. In the process, the challenges that we face are not small. We have the economic challenges. The COVID and its effect has caused a huge economic distress in the world. We will be facing the after effects of this economic distress. We have to together work towards coming out of the economic fallout of this COVID pandemic. We also witness the gathering storm or gathering clouds of new Cold War between two big countries, big powers in the world. Earlier, the Cold War in the last century happened in a different part of the world. We were not too much bothered by it. But remember, the new Cold War climate that is slowly engulfing all of us is going to be played out in our own neighborhood, in our own backyard, in the very region in which we live, namely the Indo-Pacific region. We can't afford it. In some of our countries, we have challenges like growing radicalism. These are the kind of challenges that the immediate aftermath of this virus, pandemic virus, that we all will be facing in our respective countries. Youth have to understand these challenges. Because after all, it is our destiny which is going to be affected by these things. We have to play a proactive role in our respective countries to educate our own people about the challenges that we face today, as also about the common destiny that we all have. The youth as ambassadors in respective countries, the countries in which you live, or rather I would say active, are probably motivated social activists, political activists in the respective countries that we live, but also as young youth ambassadors between ASEAN and India and other like-minded countries, we have a great role, an important role to play. I just conclude by appealing to all the youngsters who have joined in this ASEAN India Youth Dialogue to understand that youth, the age demands that we enjoy life. Youthfulness calls for a life of enjoyment, that we should. You all should enjoy your life. But globally today, youth is actually playing a very important role in shaping the destinies of societies. There are revolutions that are happening in many parts of the world. You have seen in the 21st century, countries have put an end to decades of dictatorships merely by the actions of young people. Youth have the power to change the destinies of nations. We must realize that power. We must understand our destiny, which is common to all of us, which is based on certain shared values. Those values of peace, inclusiveness, prosperity, and security. Those are the values that we all share. But also, we also must realize the challenges that they lay ahead of us and work towards overcoming those challenges. I hope that this 3-day youth summit will help in the youngsters from ASEAN countries and India ponder over many such issues, that educate us about our common destiny, but also inform us, enlighten us about our shared values. I thank you for joining in this virtual conclave and wish you all a successful conclave and successful proceedings of the conclave. Thank you and namaskar.